Happy Friday, everybody. What's going on? Welcome to the chat. It's the pre-show. What's going on? Oh, man, I need a drink. I don't know about you guys. It's Friday night, and I'm feeling good. Cheers. Oh, yeah. Okay. Give it a swirl. Excited about tonight. Lots going on. Who's in the chat room? Who's in the chat? What's going on? Oh, ATL. Hi, Jeslyn. Hi, Teresa. Hi, Jacqueline. Friday night in Akron, Ohio. Hello, Linda. What's up, Rhonda? Lorraine in Las Vegas. What's going on? It's Marilyn. Hi, in San Diego. West Virginia. Chocolate Jazz Radio in the house. What's going on? That sounds yummy. You got some wine with that? You got some wine with that chocolate? Yeah. Welcome to the show, everybody. Well, technically the pre-show. Show starts in about 4 minutes. Yeah. Thanks for hanging out. Great show tonight, Bob James, part two. You already know this. Nathan East pops by. He's got a hilarious story about Bob. You'll see. And the amazing Patches Stewart is here to jam on some muted trumpet. That's right, he is. And I have some kind of shirt on. I don't know what's going on. I don't know what's going on. Tennessee, what's up, Vanessa? How you doing? Jerry Walters is stoked. Me too. Yeah. Arlington, Texas, what's going on? Everybody's here. Lance Brown is eating sushi. So you must have some sake, or I actually like a nice Sauvignon Blanc with my sushi. But that's me, you know. People like the sake, but you know, whatever works for you. All right, 3 minutes. Yes, I'm feeling good tonight. I hope you're feeling good. It's been a week. It has been a week. Lots going on, but hey, you know, we got Seattle here. We got Richmond, Virginia. We got Robin is wearing her Hang T-shirt tonight. Yes. Can you post photos in the chat? I actually don't know. Oh, the stars are flying. Thank you, Paula. All right. Hey, don't forget another OWC gear giveaway tonight. I got this. I got the cool USB-C travel dock again tonight to give away. So make sure you're on our email list, thehang.tv. I'll pick the winner tonight at the end of the show. That's right. Yeah. Piron in Belgium is drinking Belgian beer. Very nice. Akiko. Hello from Tokyo. It's like Saturday morning in Tokyo. Good morning. So when we sing the song, it's Friday night. What do you guys do over there? It's Saturday morning. It's Saturday. It doesn't quite ring, does it? Sorry, what are you going to do? Okay. Hey, I got about a minute. I'm going to get things ready. And I'll see you over here in just about 1 minute. Okay. Keep chatting. I'm excited. Philly in the house. What's up, Michael? All right. Here we go. Marcus Anderson is here. Marcus Anderson, what's up? And Cecil Ramirez. Everybody's here. It's going to be great. Okay, see you in a minute. Almost ready. Hey, it's Brian Culbertson. We're live, and it's Friday night. Whoa! What's up, everybody? Hey. Are you feeling good tonight? Because I am. Sing it.
It's Friday night. It's Friday night.
Tokyo, it's Saturday morning. What?
It's Friday night. Night. It's Friday night.
Most places. It's a great show tonight. Bob James, the legend himself. Part two is tonight. Very excited. Lots to talk about. We got a 1 minute road story from Nathan East. And I'm jamming with Patches Stewart. That's right. What?
It's Friday night.
You know the words.
It's Friday night.
Are you jamming with your t-shirt on? Uh-huh.
It's Friday night. It's Friday night.
Uh-huh. Bam! All right. I don't know if you can tell, but I'm in a really good mood tonight. I am feeling good. It's been one of those weeks, you know, everybody has a week now and then. Do you know what I'm talking about? It's one of those weeks to where you cannot wait until Friday evening. Everything else shuts down. You pop the wine and you're just like, all right, screw it. It's the weekend. But here we are. It's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. We're here together. Thanks for joining us tonight on The Hang. Like I said, great show. Bob James, Nathan East, and Patches Stewart. Star-studded show tonight. I got great wine, too. Oh, yes. Should I tell you about it? Well, here's the deal. Here's the deal. Remember 2 weeks ago, our friends at Falcor were part of The Hang. And on the following Monday, I get an email from Lori over there, Lori Rich, our friend Lori. If you email in there, she'll talk to you, give her a call. She's amazing. Anyway, she says, Brian, there was a problem with our system. And I don't know. Long story short, we're doing part two of Falcor tonight, too. So I said, hey, it makes sense because we're doing part two of Bob James. So, you know, it's all good. So cheers to Falcor, or whatever you're drinking. And if you didn't get a chance to take advantage of their offer 2 weeks ago, you can do it tonight. So there you go. 20% off all current releases. And this is the... let me show you. I'm starting with the Les Bijoux. This one here. Hello. I feel like Vanna White. And this one over here. Pet the wine? No. 2011 Les Bijoux. Wow, that's like 9 years old. And it is tasting really nice. Really nice. Let me give it another swirl and then get another something in there. That's something else. That's really great. Okay. And there it was. What else is going on? Make sure you're signed up on our list because I am giving another cool piece of gear away at the end of the show from OWC. I think I showed you this. It's another USB-C travel dock. This thing's awesome. Anyway, giving one away for free at the end of the show. Make sure you're signed up. And I'll pick a name later. I promise. Okay. Should we get to the music? Should we just get to the music? I feel like playing a song that I typically use as the outro music of The Hang, and it's a song from my 20 album. So I thought tonight, since I actually haven't played the song, you know, played it or let it run in its entirety, I don't think ever, because I've been using it as the outro, I thought tonight I would start with it. So here it is. Sexy Love. Ooh, hey. Are you feeling good? Thank you. sex and love.
Ooh.
That was fun. That was fun. I'm ready for part two of Bob James. Here it is. And lo and behold, so many of those early records of yours ended up getting sampled. I know people ask you this all the time, but you became sort of this go-to guy for the hip-hop cats with the break beats and the different sounds that you had created, 20 years prior to that. Isn't that mind-blowing? I mean, who knew, you know?
It's still mind-blowing, Brian.
Yeah.
Don't ask me to explain it. I have no idea.
Yeah.
And I talked to a lot of the hip-hop guys recently, and yeah, it's very difficult to even have that kind of conversation because I don't know. I don't know why. I can try to imagine it. Certainly a lot of it had to do with timing.
Right.
But there was a kind of... if I have to try to explain it in any kind of logical way, the early 1970s was when straight ahead jazz was morphing into electric contemporary jazz, and the role of the bass was shifting over from upright to electric. So there were these bass lines and less emphasis on a whole bunch of chord changes. The structures were simple and stayed in the same pocket for a little bit longer, and thus easier to sample. Either easier to grab those two-bar chunks, four-bar chunks, but on this piece, Nautilus, that was on that same first record with Feel Like Making Love,
Nautilus, track, right?
In my mind and in Creed Taylor's mind, it was a throwaway. Never expected it to even get any airplay, and in fact, those days it was an LP. This was before cassettes, before CDs.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And in the LP era, there was a side A and a side B.
Yeah.
And the producers always chose the strongest cut for cut one, side A, or cut one on side B, because the outside of the LP had the wider groove, so you had better bass sound and everything. Right. And the track that got the least attention would be the last cut on side B. But that's where Nautilus resided on that record. Just crazy.
Yeah.
And the hip hop people found it anyway.
Yeah.
20 years later. So I don't know. And that tune also was definitely last minute. I knew I had the session coming up. I knew we didn't have quite enough material for the album. And we've been concentrating on Feel Like Making Love and this other classical adaptation, Night of Raw Mountain, that I did. So we just had a filler, real simple bass line, real simple hook thing, and it was the throwaway.
So a couple years after that, or a few years after that, you release your Touchdown album with Angela, of course. And I didn't realize that initially Touchdown was supposed to be the theme song.
Yeah, that's what I had submitted.
Because it sounds like a TV theme, you think of.
That's exactly what I had planned for.
Yeah.
And I had only minimal, mostly just a few telephone conferences with the producers of the series, and they hadn't really shared all that much with me about what they were looking for. And the reason why I got the call, I wasn't even doing TV music at that time at all. I wasn't pursuing it.
Yeah.
The last record that I made for Creed Taylor was called BJ4.
Right.
And they had, the producers of Taxi had that record in their collection. And they were trying a bunch of different things to see if they could find a mood.
Right.
They liked the vibe that I had on that record. So I got the call, would you just give us some more of that style? Would you be interested in following it? So I told them that since that record was made not with anything in mind that it would be sitcom, TV, short little catchy thing.
Sure.
I asked them if they would consider taking a different approach and just let me treat it as if it was a recording session for an album.
Hmm.
And not right to any music cues, not right to any.
You didn't even see any of the show.
Hadn't seen anything.
Wow.
Yeah. But I just knew it was a show about taxi drivers. That's basically about all that I knew. So I told him that I would give him some happy music, some sad music, some fast music, some slow music, and do at least a half a dozen tunes and let him pick and get started.
Yeah, yeah.
So we went in the studio and I recorded a bunch of stuff, amongst which was this piece that ended up being called Angela, but I didn't really have any idea how it was going to be used. It was just a little mellow thing that it really shocked me when they reported that the piece that I submitted that I thought was going to be appropriate for the major theme was not the one that they wanted, and that they thought that this other piece, which was in their mind, they were already anticipating using it for this first episode when the Judd Hirsch character is walking down the hallway of an apartment building to have a blind date with his answering machine operator, whose name was Angela. And so it was starting to become specific, but shortly after that, they decided that the opening shot of the taxi going across the Queensboro Bridge, dusk or whatever it was, that it was the right mood for them. And I wasn't even involved when they made that decision. It was just a piece that already existed and worked out.
And there it was. Man, isn't that cool to know where this stuff came from? Oh, thanks for sharing, Bob. I got a couple questions. Shall we go to the question cam? I think we should. Follow me. Hey, all right. Well, first of all, there was a question for Bob about Westchester Lady. You know that song? Somebody asked, is there an actual Westchester Lady? Is there a lady behind this Westchester song? And Bob says, yes, that was my wife, Judy, who inspired all my music. Aw, wow. So now you know. Now you know. Westchester Lady, it's Judy. All right, here's some other questions from Hang Club members. Isabel from Boston, Massachusetts. This is kind of a follow-up from last week, the India issue, or edition issue. I'm curious about the following. When you don't own your own music, yada, 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 how long does it last for? Is it lifelong? In essence, yes. If you're signed by a record company, they own it forever, unless you buy back the masters. So the follow-up is like, how much does that cost? I would imagine it's different for every single album out there. I was quoted. Should I say this out loud? I don't know if I should say this. But anyway, I was quoted quite a bit of a lot of money, I'm not going to say. Basically, way too much than I think I would ever make back, you know what I'm saying, on my old albums. So I'm just going to let them be. It's all good. Don't worry about it. Wade Bird from Bloomfield, Michigan says, I love your many jackets. Who does your tailoring, and can he help me with some suits? That's funny. Somebody also asked, how many jackets do I have? I don't know. I go through a bunch. It depends. Right now, I haven't bought any recently. You know. And tonight, ironically, I'm not even wearing a jacket. I don't know what this thing is. I found this. Believe it or not, I found this the last time we were in. Speaking of Japan, we were in Tokyo. And I found this. I was shopping with... Who was I with? Showcase and Chris. And Rashan. We were out walking around. They're like, B, that's dope. You got to get that. I was like, okay. So I don't know what I'm wearing tonight. Anyway, Sir Tom Baker does my jackets. He's in London. I'll call him. If you want to get some made, Wade. Hey, I think I want to play another song. Here's one from... Man, I'm going to do two from this album tonight. But I don't think I've ever played this on The Hang before, so I'm excited about this. This one's called Heroes of the Dawn. And it's a song I wrote the first time I went to L.A. It was 93, around Thanksgiving, 1993, and they had just had a huge fire out there. And I was driving around, seeing all the fire damage, and imagining the firefighters, what they had to endure. So this song is about that, seeing that. Heroes of the Dawn. Thank you. That's a fun jam right there. That's Rick Braun on the flugelhorn, Eric Marienthal on soprano saxophone. Amazing rhythm section too. Will Kennedy on drums, Jimmy Haslip on bass, Lenny Castro on percussion. So much fun. And also the late Chuck Loeb on guitar effects. Heroes of the Dawn. So that's the remake from the another Long Night Out CD. Many years later. Uh-oh. You know what it's time for? Yep. It's birthday shout-outs. All right. Hey, this week, celebrating birthdays in jazz and R&B, Tony Bennett, Greg Osby, the late Art Porter, celebrated on Monday, August 3rd. Louis Armstrong, kind of sounds like this track a little bit, kind of. Terry Lynn Carrington and Jeff Hamilton on Tuesday, August 4th. Charlie Hayden, Ravi Coltrane, celebrated yesterday, Charlie and Ravi. Sunday, Whitney Houston and Jack DeJohnette. There you go, August 9th. Well, happy birthday to you. Happy anniversary. If you're celebrating this weekend, hope you enjoy. You got some good wine? I sure do. Ah, yeah. Hey, cheers, all you birthday folks out there. Cheers to you. Well, I told you Nathan East was going to stop by for a road story, so here it is, Nathan East.
Hey, hey, I hope everybody's keeping safe and healthy. And speaking of keeping safe, I have a funny story of when 4Play played at one of the jazz festivals on the East Coast a few years back, and it was a beautiful performing arts center. And so, you know, the music of 4Play is pretty romantic. So they had set up the piano, acoustic piano had candles and flowers and all these sort of props on there just to make the mood very romantic. And so I looked back in the middle of one of the songs we were playing, and I looked back and actually the flowers had started to catch on fire while we were playing this beautiful song. And if my memory serves me correctly, Bob James just continued to play as if there was nothing going on. And I guess we got through the song before the fire brigade came up and put the fire out. But it was one of those situations where it was just it was like you couldn't believe what was going on. So Bob will be able to embellish the story a little bit because he was actually at the piano. But funny stories from the road. All right, everybody take care.
Could you imagine? Oh my goodness. Well, so he said Bob may be able to embellish. So I asked Bob about this. I said, Bob, do you even remember this? And he says, Brian, I think Nate's memory is better than mine. The only thing I remember is wondering what Liberace would have done in that circumstance. So I guess he did remember. But he's like, hey, the show must go on. And there it was. Boy, I must admit, I've never had fire on my keyboard. I'm not going to think about that. I'm going to leave that one alone. Okay. More from Bob James right now. Double Vision, which, I mean, you know, let's just say is one of the preeminent contemporary jazz albums of all time, I would say. You and Sanborn, how did you guys initially hook up?
Well, Tommy LaPuma.
Tommy, okay.
Came our producer, and he was definitely one of the people that was pushing for Dave and me to record together.
Mm.
It happened little by little, and there was kind of a confusion at first because I think Dave was actually thinking of me more as the arranger role. And because he wasn't used to having the double two lead people, the lead piano guy, the lead sax guy.
Right.
So I kind of had to beg my way into, hey, Dave, can I have a melody every now and then? You know, you want to switch over? And we joke about it.
Dave.
Now, but I think probably what made some of what made our, the magic work for us is that I loved supporting him. I knew how to make that cushion under him and make it romantic and
I was going back to your Sarah Vaughan days almost, you know.
Yeah, absolutely.
All of those instincts that when I knew that I had the right chords, the right voicing, or whatever, she would get inspired and she would just sound better. And
I feel
it instantly when that would work.
Yeah.
And sure, I was remembering that with prior to that with Earl Clue. It was the same kind of feeling where I just felt that I knew how to make him sound better and I was comfortable with that. And I only really wanted to push Dave about playing the melody occasionally more because I felt he needed contrast. In the music, if the music would breathe a little bit more, that didn't have to be playing all the time. That there was a little dialogue going on.
Give people a little break.
Give
their ears a break and make his melodies be more powerful when they came back in or something like that.
Oh, I totally agree. That's what made the magic of that album. Also, it was a time to where technology had changed in terms of your piano sound. You know, you were primarily known as the classic Fender Rhodes in the 70s era, you know, Angela and all those kinds of songs. And then the 80s come and all of a sudden the DX7 synthesizer comes out and it's very digital sounding. Still using a electric piano Rhodes-y sound, but DX7 sounded so different and more modern at that point.
Very different. And I can't remember for sure, but I believe the instrument I might have used, Yamaha had the GS1 and the GS2. Oh. The GS1 actually was shaped like a baby grand. And the GS2 was a kind of Rhode version of it. Yes, the Rhodes was the original instrument that made my reputation. I think that was time when I, for whatever reasons, I was at the right place at the right time, and I embraced it early on when a lot of the acoustic piano players a little bit turned up their nose at it if they were forced into playing it, but they were trying to play it like with the same touch as an acoustic piano, and I can't overplay it because it's you've got to adjust your tone and your touch, and I like that challenge.
Yeah. So years after Double Vision, I'm skipping over so many things because we can't talk about it all. Foreplay happens. Oh my God! I mean, it's just everything you do is just like huge. It's really amazing. You get together with, obviously you'd been working with Harvey Mason for years on all your sessions and albums, but then you hook up with Nathan and Lee, and I know you were recording your Grand Piano Canyon album. Was that what it was?
Yes. Well, thank you very much for helping me revisit the history. And yes, it's long and there's a lot of stuff, but when you're as old as I am, you got to have some kind of history.
Well,
and our highlights, and certainly Foreplay was a major, another one that has a little bit similar kind of, little bit of a fluke that it happened. The circumstances were that I always loved playing with Harvey Mason. Mm-hmm. And most of the time, since I was living in New York, I was inviting Harvey to fly out and do the sessions in New York with me.
Wow.
But for whatever reason, we decided that I was going to come out to LA to record several pieces for my Grand Piano Canyon album with Harvey. And I had just begun talking with Lee Ritenour about the possibility of reciprocal, because we all at that time, it was very convenient if we were going to be a sideman on their project and the leader on the next project, if you just said, okay, I'll do one,
trade.
One for me, whatever. So it was my turn with Lee to call in the Chits and ask him to play on my record because I had played on one of his records.
Uh-huh.
We were just in, well, since I knew Lee and Harvey, I asked them who I should use on bass because I didn't know any of the bass players in L.A. So independently, both Harvey and Lee mentioned the same name, Nathan East. So I didn't feel I should argue with that. And he ended up being our bass player. And when we talked about it afterwards, we all felt that there was some unusual kind of magic going on in the room.
Man, so cool to hear these stories. Hey, I just realized it's 37 minutes after the hour, and I need to switch over to wine number two. That's a good pour. Okay, here's what I'm drinking. Number two, this is it. The wine cam. Okay, I am drinking the 2014 Napa Valley Cabernet Sauvignon, but it's the Premier Collection. I don't know what that exactly means, but I can only assume that's their extra good grapes. Is that what that means, Lori? Okay. Cheers. Cheers. And I got a special song for this wine. Oh yeah. Ooh. Maybe time to light the candles, but not too close to the flowers. You're my music.
Oh, baby, listen now. I see you first thing in the morning. I love the way you shine when the sun is rising. And every day, all I wanna do is hear your voice. It's like you strike a chord in my heart, babe. And even when it stops, you still sustain. You're the best melody in my life. 'Cause every time I think of you, I know that you inspire me in every song. In every song, baby, when I'm touching you, it takes me home. Cause I will never ever stop till you're satisfied. Just open up and sing it to me loud and clear. Oh, this is real, no need to pretend. And I hope this will never end. 'Cause you're the only melody in my life. 'Cause every time I think as you are. I could say you're a star, but you are so far beyond this universe. When we create this music we make, just keep it on replay. Oh, baby, 'cause every time I think
That's Noel Gordine there. Paired nicely with that cab. Not gonna lie. Hey, it's time to hang out with my buddy. Man, telling you, we've had so much fun on the road. From hanging out on the Smooth Jazz Cruise to being on my funk tour and touring over the last few years. He's one of the greatest trumpet players ever. Talking about Patches Stewart. This is a song he played on one of my records called Horizon.
Thank you.
Patches, man. What an amazing player. Such a vibe. Such a vibe. Thank you, Patches. And I'm telling you, I'm ready to get back on the road so we can hang out together. Not on a screen. But anyway. All right. Hey, here's the rest of the story about how Bob James founded 4Play with the other cats. Here's the rest of the story.
There was something different about the way it felt.
Hmm.
They all seemed to be having the same kind of desire, attitude, whatever.
It gelled.
On a break, this conversation came up about whether any of us had been a member of a group, because we were talking about the idea that a group has a different identity than the individual artists that are involved in it. And we always, I think all of us wonder why certain groups have longevity. Based upon that conversation, I had just taken on a job in the A&R, jazz A&R department at Warner Brothers. So I went into a meeting at Warner Brothers with the idea, would they sponsor a project for a new group? And they liked the idea. So I was able to go back to the other three guys and say, I think I've got a label for us and a budget. And so really very soon after that, our first album got made. And we really were serious about having it be a group. It wasn't, we weren't, in fact, we were hoping that it wouldn't turn out to be that sort of one-off all-star group that,
oh, cool.
And we knew that we'd have to pay some dues in order for that to happen. All of the guys had their own solo reputations, we were busy. And as the years went on, that probably was our biggest challenge, is to have the time and the commitment to make the group happen.
Trying to coordinate schedules, I can't imagine. You know, everybody touring and this and that.
It was rough. And,
yeah.
And guitar players turn out to be fickle also. So we went through three guitar players because they, with Lee and Larry,
yeah.
Ultimately they decided that the group thing was not for them at that time, and they wanted to pursue their own solo careers.
Yeah.
I think Chuck, and tragically Chuck passed away, but I think he would have stayed for the duration. I think Chuck was more committed and really loved the role that he was able to play for us, and still keep his solo career going too.
Right. Is there a new guitar player percolating at all in the future, maybe?
Well, there's a new old somewhat percolating. That's basically what we're trying to put together, and haven't totally put it together yet, but we want to go back to the original, and Lee has expressed interest in having a kind of reunion of the original group.
That'd be amazing.
So if the COVID-19 ever gets out of the way and if ever back to somewhat of a normal situation, we're thinking about that as a possibility for next year.
Well, that's exciting. Yeah. Great news there.
I felt that we should, at least during the course of this interview, mention our mutual friend Paul Brown.
Who, yeah.
I think I probably first found out about you through the either Mind Games or one of the things that you were working on with Paul.
Yeah, this is actually, it's an interesting story because Paul Brown had asked me to kind of contribute a couple songs to his pool of music that he had. And the next thing I know, both these songs are on your record. I'm like, wow, how did this happen? We never even had met at that point.
Oh, really?
I don't think so. Your latest album, Espresso, I'm telling you, I you know, it's really great to just put that on. It's a chill record. It's very acoustic, and I just love the sound. Can I play a little clip of my favorite song on the Espresso album?
Absolutely.
Okay, here it is. This is Shadow Dance.
Thank you.
chord changes are really amazing. I love these. So
thank you.
Well, Bob, I appreciate you for being here. Thanks for taking the time. I just wish you all the best on everything to still come. I know there's a lot of great stuff still going to happen. I'm looking forward to the reunion with Lee next year, hopefully.
I hope so, too.
And whatever else may come. So, Bob James, thank you, man.
Thank you for having me on the hang. And I know it's frustrating sometimes for keyboard players because it's very rare that, you know, if I get the gig, you don't. And if you get the gig, I don't. There's usually only one of us in the band.
Yeah, but you can have like 30 sax players on stage, but only one keyboard player.
But you could kill it on the trombone and maybe do both, you know.
Oh, hey, we will do something. We will do something.
I would love that very much.
The legend, Bob James. How cool was that? Oh, my goodness. Well, hey, cheers, Bob. Now I have some wine. Official cheers to you. And I got another song for you while we drink. Oh, yes.
Can I take your order?
Yeah, B, what you want, man? What you want?
I don't know. Whatever you're getting, man.
Okay, let me get 2 orders of 4 wings with salt, pepper, mild sauce, and put the bread on top.
Oh, baby, we had a mild sauce.
What?
Are you kidding?
How can they be out of it? That's messed up. Let's go find it. Are you with me? Stay with it.
Did you get it? Oh my goodness. Well, folks, I can't believe the hour is up already. But you know, we gotta sing it out. We got to sing it. Now that we found the mild sauce, we got our wine, we got everything. It's Friday night, and I still gotta give away some gear. What? It's Friday night. Oh, yes. Here it is.
It's Friday night, 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 night.
Don't go anywhere.
It's Friday night.
Oh, yeah. I'll do that right after this song. But next week, it's a big show. It's a big show. Should I tell you? Okay. I miss touring so much. Next week, 100% live jams. What?
It's Friday night.
Yes. I'm retching back into my live archives. We'll be jamming along to some songs.
Night, 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 night. It's Friday night.
Oh, I'll be jamming with some songs, all kinds of songs, the whole hour. What?
The entire hour next week. Live jams. I don't know about you, but I'm missing it. So that's what we're going to do. Hey, I'm going to give away this amazing USB-C dock right now.
And the winner is,
Carol Allen. You won it. Check your email this weekend. Ben will email you. You'll be hooked up. Amazing. All right, y'all. Have a great night. Enjoy your Falcor. Get it in. Order your t-shirt. And we got some Stay With It hats coming, too. What? See you in the chat.
Oh, man. All right, what's going on over here, folks?
Yes, live jams. All live jams next week. I'm putting on a concert. An hour's worth of live stuff. It's going to be a lot of fun. Me and the piano. I'm going to have to bust out the trombone. You know I'll have to bust out the... Bust out the bone.
And hey, guys, after this show, in just a few minutes, Marcus Anderson is going live on his Facebook page. Marcus Anderson, we were supposed to be in Asheville, North Carolina tonight playing his Coffee and Jazz Escape. So he's doing an online virtual concert tonight. Him, his band, with Kenny Lattimore. So definitely migrate on over to Marcus's page. I'm going to share it on my page so you can have it. But they're going to play in a two-hour concert tonight. Wow. It's crazy. It's going to be amazing. So stick around for that. I'll share that on my page. And, man, it's been a great night. Thanks again to Bob James, Nathan East, Patches Stewart, my dude, Falcor Wines, OWC, Smooth Jazz Cruise, and all of you for watching, especially those of you in the Hang Club. Some of you have been asking, what is the Hang Club all about? It's a lot of cool stuff. I'll tell you. Full interviews. Download the episodes. Ask questions. I'll get back to you. All kinds of stuff. Thank you, Marilyn. She says, I need to practice the trombone anyway, so... definitely, I'll be staying with it. Mm-hmm. Well, we got Stay With It t-shirts coming. Oh, no, hats coming. You'll see. Working it out. Ay, ay, ay. Anyway, thanks, Jess. Glad you enjoyed the interview. All right, Mexico's in the house. Hi, Ivan. Hey, man, what's going on? Yeah. All right.
Rhonda likes the shirts.
Cheers, you guys.
Next week, live jams. It's going to be crazy. It's going to be a lot of fun. Tell your people.
Tell your people. Set up the lights at your house. We got set up for the live concert next Friday night. Oh my God. It's going to be fun. It's going to be so fun. Yeah. No interviews, not much talking, 100% live jams next Friday night. All right, y'all. Catch you later.
Bye.